Number 15, repeat exercise 5.14 for a car with four-wheel drive. All right, so I copy and pasted number 14 in here. So just quickly, I drew a picture at the bottom, but if we're trying to find the maximum acceleration with a 4-degree slope, all right, and that's basically it. Otherwise, the rest of the question is going to be different. In terms of letter A, we're going to try to find this on dry concrete. In this particular video, I'm going to go through it a little faster. If you need a little more help, feel free to check out question 14. I went into detail about how everything works, and this one I'm just going to now basically apply those concepts. All right. So first, to start off, here's my picture. All right, 4-degree incline. Here's the car. Now they want to know for four-wheel drive. All right. There's two ways to solve this problem. Either you do a free body diagram and you detail only one of the four wheels. All right, so you pick your wheel and you draw your axes, all right, and you realize that the weight, that's terrible, but you realize the weight on one wheel is going to be W over 4, and you do all your components and everything, and you find the force applied. And then after you find the force applied, you got to apply multiply that by 4 because you got 4 wheels, and then you get your total, okay? This would be the total force applied, all right? You can definitely do it that way. If that's how you see it, by all means, do that. But I'm not going to do it that way. There is a shorter way. I'm just going to look at the car as a whole car, all right? Because all the weight is being accelerated by the four wheels. So what I'm going to do, simply draw my axis, all right? Then what I'm going to do is rotate this, all right? Bring it on over, and then I will rotate it. So the x-axis is parallel with the slope, and that looks pretty good to me. Now what I'm going to do from here is I'm going to imagine that this whole car is basically centered at this particular point. Now that whole car has a weight to it, correct? We don't know what it is, but we don't need to know what it is. That whole weight is pointing straight down, correct? All right. So that whole weight is pointing straight down, called W. Now the angle in here, and the reason why I rotate the plane all the time for you guys, is because I want you to get a feel for what this angle in here should be. Right, the angle in there should be equal to the angle of incline. So this right here is going to be simply 4 degrees. All right, that'll always be the case. Meaning the angle between your weight vector and the negative y-axis will always be equal to the angle of your plane, assuming the plane is in reference to the horizontal. Okie dokie. Now, where do we have to go from here? Well, remember, the ultimate goal in this problem is to figure out what's the maximum acceleration this car can experience on up the hill. Now that acceleration will be directly dependent on how the tires grip the road. All right, so we're talking about static friction here, no slippage. So what I'm going to first do, I realize that in order to calculate the force of friction, right, if we're looking at our formulas, I got to know the normal force in order to know which is drawn here, right? In order to know that normal force, so F sub N, in order to know that normal force, guess what I got to know? I got to know the Y component of the weight. This component, right? I'll call this W sub Y. And it's negative, right? Because it's pointing down. All right, so how do I do that? Well, if you notice, this thing makes a little triangle, right? And this triangle will be important. This X component here, all right? Let's call that negative W sub X. But first, let's focus on the Y component. So how do I find this? Well, it's a triangle. I know the hypotenuse. I know this angle. I'm looking for the side adjacent. Therefore, I'm going to use cosine, right? So just simply doing this out, it's going to be W sub Y is going to be equal to negative I'll call it negative W cosine of 4. Okay, wonderful. Now, that takes care of that. Then remember that the normal force is equal but opposite in sine of the W sub Y. So if this value is the value for W sub Y, then the value for the normal force should be just the opposite sign. So it's going to be positive. So W cosine of 4. All right. And now the reason why this is important is because now this allows me to connect it to my force of static friction formula. So remember that the force of static friction is less than or equal to the coefficient of static friction multiplied by the normal force. But instead now of the normal force, I'm going to substitute this on in. So I get the force of static friction being less than or equal to the coefficient of static friction multiplied by W cosine of 4. Okay, very good. What does that even mean? Where does that vector point? Where is the force of friction in my picture? You might say, oh, wait a minute. Yeah, we're accelerating upward, so this is pointing back. Unfortunately, not correct. It makes sense. It sounds like it should, right? But you got to really get into the physics of what's going on here. All right, what do I mean by that? Well, let me detail the picture up here quickly. So here, I'm just going to draw one of the tires. How are the tires rotating if they're trying to accelerate the car upward? How are they rotating? They're rotating this way, right? They're rotating clockwise. How are the tires actually propelling the car upward? Well, as they rotate clockwise, they're gripping the road and they're pushing back right on the road. Okay, but that's a backward force. What the heck is pushing it forward? Well, Newton's third law, right? For every action, there's an equal but opposite reaction. So if this wheel is trying to push the ground backwards, guess what the ground is doing to the tire, or to the car, I should say, pushing it forward. So, we're trying to look for an acceleration up the hill, so I need some force applied. So guess what? The frictional force we just found, which happens between the wheel and the road pushing it back, is equal but opposite to the force that the road provides to the wheels, and then therefore to the car. Remember, we're concerned with forces acting on the car, not by the car. This frictional force is acting by the car, and then the force applied is acting on the car by the road. All right, so guess what? This frictional force, all right, I'm really going to rename it, because I can, because of Newton's third law, to a force applied. And I'm just going to change this from less than or equal to now equal to, because I'm trying to find the maximum. All right, so this becomes mu sub s w cosine of 4. And this is the force applied. Now, where does that exist in my picture? That exists right here, right? That's the force propelling it upwards. That's the positive x value. This is the force applied. All right, great. So we got that x value force. And now, what's the other x value force in the problem? It's the x component of the weight. So how do we calculate for that? So this is very straightforward, right? Your trigonometry, you're going to use sine in here, okay? Because you're looking for the opposite side of this angle and you know the hypotenuse. So simply, W sub x will equal negative W sine of 4. All right, I'm just trying to do a little shortcut here, trying to get through this quickly. All right, now remember, the only reason why I'm getting through this quickly is because I developed the ideas very detailed in number 14. So feel free to check that out. So now what we can do is now we can finally start plugging it into my sum of the forces in the x direction formula. Remember, I'm looking for an acceleration. All right. So what are the forces in the x direction? We talked about them already. The applied force and the x component of the weight. So we have the applied force being positive and minus then the weight in the x axis. Okay. Is equal to ma x. Great. So now if I knew these values, I could just plug them in and go about my business. And if I knew the mass, I could solve. We don't know them, so we got to substitute, we got to create equations, in which case we can cancel some important variables. So now I'm going to substitute this on in for my applied force. So now that is mu sub s times w, and let me put this in parentheses, cosine of 4, okay? Now here's the thing, minus, all right, I already added the negative sign into my equation, so you might be saying, well, wait, negative sign here. Now I'm going to plug in this negative sign. So wouldn't it be positive? Well, no. Yes, it would be in terms of the math, but I already put this in as negative. Okay. Meaning I already told you it's negative. It's just being confirmed here. If I had placed this as a positive, which that would be a better term, right? If I were thinking about the sum, because I would take FA plus W sub X, and then I would say, okay, plus the value of W sub x, and oh, the value of W sub x is negative, so this would then be a negative, blah, blah, blah. I'm just skipping that step, okay? So I'm just putting it in as negative already, but I'm remembering that in my head that I'm not going to put the negative in again because I'm double counting it, all right? So, you can do it either way. I like to do it this way personally, but you can definitely do it the other way. Doesn't matter. So minus W sine of 4 is equal to MAX. Where do we go from here? Well, let's pull out a common factor of W from both of the terms on the left-hand side. If I do that, then this becomes mu sub S cosine of 4 minus sine of 4 is equal to MAX. Now what do we do? Expand the W. Remember, weight is equal to MG. So I can do MG here. Mu sub S cosine of 4 minus sine of 4 equals MAX. And now what? We've seen this now 17 times in the past 15 problems, which doesn't make any sense, but I feel like we have at least. So we cancel the masses, right? So now G is equal to mu sub S cosine of 4 minus sine of 4 is equal to AX. And by the way, that's actually a good thing. If you get to that point when you're studying, when you're like, oh my God, this again, that's good. That means you know how to do it. That means you're so bored that it's just so easy, right? That's where you want to be. So I finally get down to this very important formula. Okay. Oop, let me make that line a little better. I don't know what's going on. There we go. So now what we can do is now we can finally solve the problem, right? We're looking for this on letter A. It said dry concrete. So we have to know the value for dry concrete in terms of the coefficient of static friction. And I'm going to give that to you. You can look it up in the table. But for then letter A, the coefficient of static friction for dry concrete was 1.0. So now all we got to do in the formula down here is plug 1.0 in for mu sub S and just calculate it, right? So let's do that. So we got 1 times cosine of 4 minus sine of 4. Multiply that bad boy by 9.8, and we get 9.09. So the acceleration here in the x direction is going to be 9.09 meters per second squared. If you compare it to number 14, it's greater, which that should make sense, right? Everybody who wants the race wants four-wheel drive. Why? Because it grips the road better. Well, okay, what does that do for you? It gives you better acceleration, okay? Obviously, that's not the only thing that gives you better, right? It's all about engine power. I got that for all the car people out there. But that's the basic premise. So now for letter B, right? The coefficient of static friction now, if you go to letter B, it says on wet concrete, that value, if you look it up in the table, was 0.7. Okay. I'm starting to memorize all these values from the table now, doing it so often. So we have mu sub s, so it's 0.7 times cosine of 4 minus sine of 4. And then take that and multiply it by 9.8. So here we get 6.16. So the acceleration here is 6.16, right? Meters per second squared. Okay, so that works for that one. Let me just make sure I didn't make a silly mistake on that. 0.7 times, no, that's good. Minus sine of 4. Yeah, no. Okay, so that's good. And then last but not least, letter C, it says on ice. So I'll put letter C. Well, I ran out of room there, right? But I'll put letter C on down here. So we have the coefficient of static friction is 0.100. Now let's calculate its acceleration by plugging that into the formula there. So we get 0.1 times cosine of 4 minus sine of 4. And that now will be multiplied by 9.8. So cool. So we get a value here of 0.294 meters per second, right? Meters per second squared. And now compare that answer to the answer we got last time in number 14. Remember, letter C was the same thing, but it was only a two-wheel drive car. And what was the acceleration there on ice? It was negative. So you were sliding down the hill. But now this person, it doesn't even matter what the mass is. That's interesting. Doesn't matter how heavy the vehicle is here. All that matters is now that you have four-wheel drive, all of a sudden your acceleration went from being negative with only two-wheel drive to now being positive, which means that it is traveling up. Thank goodness. All right. So guys, thank you so much for tuning in. I really do hope this helped. Please remember to subscribe. I would thank you very much. And I will see you in the next video. Thank you.